Everybody, it's Adam Duff from adamduff.com, and today I'm actually going to do something a little bit different. I have a suggestion from Mirwan Joma. I apologize if I'm butchering your name. Please correct me if I'm saying it wrong. I'm not exactly sure about what the pronunciation is, but he has a really good idea here. He wrote in, you know the new film Maleficent? It has some treant-like humanoid figures like this, and here's the example he provides. So I think it would be cool to create something more some more humanoid treants, and maybe push it to the direction of Avatar, Na'vi style. You guys should be familiar with Avatar. If you're not, you probably lived a very sheltered life. There could be, for example, figures with bodies made for war or heel-type figures. That has a harp integrated. Keep it up. Enjoyed King's Harem and your YouTube channel. Well, thank you very much, Mirwan. Let's give it a shot then. It sounds like an awesome idea. It's definitely something that I think I can have a lot of fun with. So I'm going to start with just a block and some shapes. Trying to come up with something original. And I'm going to start to flesh out what this guy's going to look like. From some age. He's not a warrior character. I'm not going to give him I don't think I would go in the Na'vi warrior style, just because from my particular style, my particular tastes. When I think of trees, I think of them being healers, right? I think of them being ancient and more emotional and verbal creatures than fighters, so to speak. You know what I mean? I know that there's plenty of artists that would love to jump on that idea, though. It's definitely cool. But for me in particular, it's generally where I tend to go. Just gonna move it around, start with the basic idea, see where I can take it from there. Actually, you know what? I don't think I'm going to think body just yet. Let's just work straight ahead with this one. Trying to bring in a wide range of values right away. Find some nice forms. And try not to repeat elements too much, not to repeat like same directions and stuff like that. I don't want to make it feel too redundant. Maybe giving him some kind of a wide rib cage, like a cage of branches or something like that. That might be interesting. Compassion. I'm thinking compassion. What kind of? Maybe a little tilt to the head. If you think in terms of body language, I think a little tilt to the head is a very powerful way to evoke a sense of gentleness and friendliness in a face. Whenever you tilt a head over, you're creating a bit of a feeling of repose in the head, that as if you're laying your head down on a pillow, which makes a character feel a little bit less threatening. Maybe having think some kind of, like his vertebrae are kind of poking out a little bit, like the beginnings of vines or something like that. I'm thinking about feeling and movement. I'm not thinking technical. Oh, like his body's supposed to look like this, or it's supposed to look, I'm suggesting anatomy. I'm suggesting some kind of an anatomy there. But seeing as how I'm thinking about an ancient tree, there's going to be a lot of warped forms and deformities in his anatomy. So I'm trying to keep this very loose, trying to find some original shapes in there. I'm not keeping myself too tight. Trying to find nice sinuous forms to add an element of grace. Seeing curves that travel around and all kinds of stuff. But I don't want to keep it too. This is kind of making him look a little bit. It looks starting to look a bit like a centaur beard or something like that. This is a tree character, so I want to think about bark. Add some kind of a design element that really kind of shoots out, creates a strong focal point. So I'm going to give my canvas a little bit more space for now. I can always shrink it down later. Notice I'm using the basic round brush here. I'm not using any texture brushes for this one. I have shape dynamics turned off on top of it. Whenever I see lines like this, I remember I was chatting with a buddy of mine who works at Funcom, and he was watching me paint at one point. And he said, "You have a cartoon background, don't you?" And I said, "How the hell did you notice?" I was like, "How do you notice that I have a cartoon background? Because I can tell by your lines and your forms. You've always got this kind of, you've always got this kind of graphic style to your line and forms and stuff like that." And I was like, "Yeah, God, I was trying to hide that, but thanks for noticing, Mr. Professional." But it's kind of, it's a part of me. It's kind of a hard habit to break. But in the end, it plays into the whole personal style thing, I guess, right? So. See, I'm starting with a branch that's thick, and then it suddenly gets thin, and then it gets thick again. Sound. Every time you hear that very gut-piercing ting, it's because I second-guessed myself. I was hitting one shortcut and then I was decided to change my mind and not do what I was going to do, and Photoshop gave me shit for it. We move forward, not backward. We do not second-guess ourselves. I don't want to approach. Sorry. I have to disable that bloody thing, that feature, because God, it's horrible on the ears. I'm sure you guys don't appreciate hearing that either, but I'll see if I can take that noise out in post-production. Yeah, I'm definitely taking that out. I'm gonna make enemies leaving that noise in my video. So yeah, I'm basically in post-production. I deleted certain noises, and I'm sitting here piercing, cringing to noises that you aren't even hearing going on about it. So yeah, so I basically sound like a complete lunatic. Just bear with me. Shapes together. Start to render out some three-dimensional forms. Suggest a cheekbone. I try to approach it in a way that it kind of naturally blends into these organic designs that I'm creating. I want to keep the tips dark. I like that that visual contrast with the darker tips to his kind of branch-like antler things going on. Creating a little bit of negative space, which is always nice on the eyes. People appreciate that kind of stuff. Ability to see through a character like this creates a nice, creates for a more interesting silhouette as well. You probably hear the radio playing in the background, maybe not. I don't know. I have the news playing in the background. Just need a little breathing room for me. Try to create an extension through his chin. Get a nice line of action through his body. I'm thinking with these branches to suggest actual must the placement of actual muscles in the human body, so think this would suggest a bicep in the forearm muscles, muscles around the wrist and the tendons. It's an idea, at least. It might stick, it might not. Something about this rib cage. I think I need to kind of suggest some latissimus muscles, some back muscles to. Flesh out that form, make it a little bit more believable. Give it a bit more of a humanoid feel. Starting to take shape. What's important, what I'm doing on purpose is, I have Mirwan's example over on the other screen, and I don't want to I don't want to look at it too much because that'll start throwing me off and making me second guess my own design, right? So it's something you got to watch out for. There's artists that you really like that you're very inspired by, do not look at their work. You're just going to get discouraged. Just stay true to what you're doing. You got your own vision, and you should, respect it. You have a vision. And just because your stuff does not look like other people's artwork or look like the reference material that you're looking at, trust that your own brain has its own sense of direction. If you respect that, then that's when you create unique, original stuff. But there's always going to be some kind of a distraction that's going to throw you off base type of thing, so I always make a point of avoiding Getting too caught up in other people's work while I'm working. When I'm not working, I don't care, because then I can just enjoy their stuff and get inspired and, appreciate the quality of their stuff and stuff like that. But not when I'm working, because that just really screws me up. Really trying to get that old, ancient, gnarled look. I put out a tutorial a couple of years ago, Old Mother You, several years ago. It's a pretty old video now, more of a cartoony type style to it, but I had a chance to really research old yew trees in Scotland and stuff like that a lot, and I had a lot of fun because it's just something I just enjoy so much. Thinking now I need to add a little bit more depth to these branches. So I'm going to grab the value. It's a little bit lower, and I'm going to add some more at the other side of his head. Like, I'm almost imagining that the back of his head is almost hollowed out. It's just kind of the circular form of branches. There's something going on there that's kind of catching my attention. And I'm just going to use value to suggest that it's kind of fading off into the fog or the distance. A little bit of artistic license there. Just to suggest that depth. This is essentially a value painting. So I'm, allowing the whiteness of my canvas to play a part in the design. It's a bit of a design choice here. And in my head, I'm still kind of in the quote unquote kind of blocking phase of this. I'm still establishing what the main shapes are. I haven't gotten into rendering out any detail of any kind. I just want to get a nice solid silhouette, create something that's visually pleasing to look at. And then from there, I can go in and start fleshing out all these fine details and adding character and all that crap. Yes, I said crap. So naughty. The reason why I apologize for swearing is because if my 4-year-old's anywhere near me, she gives me shit all the time. That's a bad word, Daddy. You don't say that. And because my daughter's clever, and she loves getting away with stuff all the time, she's going to say, Daddy, you're not allowed to say crap. And she'll really overpronounce the word crap, which both, fills my soul with guilt, and at the same time, I can't get mad at her because she was correcting me and she knows it. She's a real smart little bugger. She uses it to get away with being naughty all the time. You're not allowed to say crap, Daddy. You're not allowed to say shit. Shit is a bad word, Daddy. You don't say shit. I'm like, oh God. Yeah, oh, thank you, sweetie. Stop saying that. And I say she takes after her dad. I can't hate on her for that. When you find yourself having a conversation, when you find yourself telling your at the time 3-year-old daughter, things like, use your intelligence to do good things, sweetie. With great power comes great responsibility. Then you're out of your league. That girl's going to be walking circles around me, and no, she all what am I talking about? She already is walking circles around me. All the girls in my family walk circles around me. I don't stand a chance against them. Too smart for their own good. Something going on. Not quite sure what it is, but something. Now, I'm thinking of having him cup something in his hand. And what's inspiring this hand position? I have a little statuette on my desk that's been sitting there for a long time. It was a gift from my mother. Well, it was originally in my mother's house, but every time I went over to her house, I said, God, I love that. It's a statuette of a Chinese shoemaker that I totally fell in love with. And I always have it sitting next to me on my desk. And I'm always glancing over it every now and then. It's kind of a feel-good statuette. And this is kind of reminiscent of the type of pose he has. In his case, he's kind of sitting on the shoemaker's bench, and he's studying, checking the sole. He's kind of fashioning the sole for a shoe, and he's looking at it, and kind of has this kind of expression. I kind of like that. See if I could bring some of that into my painting. I like that because it kind of suggests wisdom and patience and a little bit of compassion in his work, right? The slight tilt to the head is very, very strong visual. Thank you, Mr. Porsche. Yes, I'm very impressed you own an expensive car. Thank you for driving at 2,000 kilometers an hour down a residential street, you moron. I don't know if you ever saw there was a, I love this British commercial. It's kind of like this spoof, kind of a video editing commercial thing where it's this little tiny little cute little kind of hamlet village in England somewhere, I'm not exactly sure where it takes place, and there's this old guy, and he's outside at the end of his driveway, and he's got this kind of device he's fashioned, and he It's like you find out, you soon find out after that it's a speed bump that he's created. And there's this guy down the street, revving his car. And so he goes and he quickly runs out on the street and fastens it to the road and then goes and hides behind a bush or something like that. And this sports car comes driving down the street full speed. And when it goes over a speed bump, it literally catapults the car like 6,000 feet in the air, like boom, up in the air, and you just see it get tossed off into the horizon. It's so freaking funny. And everybody who's seen that video that I know goes, God, I wish those actually existed in real life. If it's a residential street and you're driving faster than 80 kilometers an hour, you just get frisbeed into the landscape. I always love that commercial. Every time I hear a fast car go down my street, because it's a real family street, so I live in a little residential area where there's lots of kids running around. When I hear people driving on the street like that, it just makes me cringe. Yeah, I'm a daddy. Sorry. I react. I drive like an old person, and I get angry at fast drivers. Suggestion of a thumb in there. We spent about 30 minutes on it. I think I got a good enough blocking that I can start moving forward with adding a little bit of refinement and detail into this thing. Kind of starting to look interesting. And then I'm going to pause the video and get a bite to eat because it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I haven't had my lunch yet. My tummy's starting to give me attitude, so having too much fun putting content up on the website and chatting with people on the forum and stuff like that. It's a lot of fun. So it's fun, yeah, but I got to remember to eat too. It's kind of a bad habit of mine. I don't really look at the clock often enough. That's why I always make a point, like with my, with the lifestyle where you have the type of work where you're sitting down a lot, and I can sit for long hours at a day. I make a point of going to the gym 3 to 4 times a week, and I force myself to do it, even if I'm really caught up in my work. I go to the gym, I take regular breaks, I stand up, I don't sit for too long, do a few stretches to, so that it doesn't start affecting the circulation in my back or my legs. Get the adrenaline moving, do sit-ups, go for a jog, that kind of stuff. I try to keep myself regularly active and in shape so I don't, so I can keep doing what I love longer, right? You neglect your body after a while, it catches up with you. Trust me. If you're younger and you're just starting off on this field, and you're really, really ambitious, yeah, be ambitious, but take care of your health, so. That kind of stuff is not fun. I haven't quite figured out what I'm going to do with his hips, but we'll get back to it. I'll just fade it off. All right, so I think we got a good blocking. I'm going to pause the video. I'm going to go grab a bite, and I'll be back to work a little more on Mirwan Joma's treant concept. All right, so thanks for watching. Keep watching, because I'm just going to pause the video, so there's no time lapse for you. All right, just wait. All right, I'm back. Did you miss me? No? Yes? Anybody? Anybody? Bueller? 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 No, nothing. Never mind. So yeah, so I made myself a nice lunch. I made myself a salad with spinach and tomatoes and cucumbers and avocados and Brazil nuts, or as they say in Brazil, Brasil. A nice balsamic vinegar dressing. I don't feel like I want to climb a wall anymore, because since I was a little kid, when I get hungry, I get pissy, apparently. My mother used to tell me that when I was a kid, when I was young, I had such a voracious appetite that when I'd start to get hungry, I would start to complain a lot, right? My son's the same way. When he gets hungry, he's just miserable, miserable creature. And she told me I used to threaten to run away. I got, nobody loves me, I'm gonna run away. And my mother, of course, calling my bluff every time, would go, okay, sweetie, just remember to close the door on your way out, your way out. It's a little chilly outside. I don't want you to let in the draft. And I was like, oh, how could you? And I get so upset. And I said, I'm really running away. She said, no, that's fine, sweetie, that's fine. Just don't leave the door open. I get so pissed off. And I said, that's it. I'm leaving. And, I'd slam the door to let her know that it was this was the big one. I'm not coming back this time. And I'd walk down to the corner of my street, and then I'd realize I'm not allowed to cross the street. So I decide to go around the block and kind of hide out one block away type of idea, where she couldn't find me, but of course she knew where I was because I couldn't get very far. And then she'd come around the block and say, Adam, dinner. Sit there, I'd maul and sulk for a couple of minutes and stuff like that, and then I'd go, fine, and I'd go back home and I'd walk back in the house, still upset because I wanted to know I was still very angry with her that she betrayed me and didn't love me and let me run away. And then the moment she stuck something in my mouth, I would have this kind of almost schizophrenic switch of personality, and all of a sudden I start smiling and joking and giggling. My mother never even batted an eyelash about it the whole time. So yeah. So when food calls, I come answering. So now at this point I have a blocking, and now I'm gonna start actually detailing some of this stuff out, rendering out some three-dimensional forms, adding detail at this point. When it comes to any kind of piece, once you've gotten past the whole blocking in phase, which you should always treat very lightheartedly, you don't come in and say, okay, I gotta get this perfect. No, keep a very relaxed attitude about it. Then you can allow your creativity to float, you can create original stuff, and once you have that fleshed out, from that point you can move forward with it, and it's just a question of detailing things out. That's all. You can grab some reference if you need. I have a little bit of a reference here. Actually, let me show you here. Right there. Let's see. I'm using that as a reference right now for just different ideas on how I can approach the texture of the bark and stuff like that. Kind of suggests some kind of cheekbone structure coming down into a mouth. Little touch of value, not too much, just a little touch of value, just to help that lip pop a little bit. I'm probably going to be adding another light pass to this to add a little bit more depth to the piece, but for now I just need enough to feel out these three-dimensional forms. Oh God, that sound again. Those three-dimensional forms, and I even know when it's going to happen, eh? When that noise is going to hit. I cringe, because I know that when I hit my eraser button, I might very well get that big piercing ding, which of course you don't hear. So I'm t basically what I'm complaining about, you have no clue. You have no clue what I'm talking about. But I don't care. See, that's the cool thing. I really don't care. What was I talking about? I was talking about something and I went off on a tangent. Now I forget that. I forgot what I was talking about. Couldn't have been that important. Probably very frustrated right now because you're probably yelling at your screen going, "You were talking about this, you idiot!" And I can't hear you because this is pre-recorded. But you know what? Yell away. If it helps you let off some steam, then you're more than welcome. No, I'm just basically blending dark values to light values, finding hard edges, soft edges, some nice warped shapes. Get a nice, some nice visual variety. See what I can do in terms of eyes. I want to add a little bit of, I want to capture some kind of a compassionate expression in his face, showing that actually, you know what? I'm going to pause the video. I'm going to grab that statuette. Where is he sitting? Let me find that statuette so I can actually use his expression as reference. All right, so I got grab my little statuette. He's sitting next to me now. He's got a look of concentration in his face. Actually, you know what? Instead of painting on another layer, I'm just going to duplicate so I can move things around a little bit more easily. Love that statuette so much. Not going to use a no I'm not going to give it a nose, just to give it a little bit more of an otherworldly type of expression. And the cartoonist in me is going to do a little bit of stretch and squash in the facial expression. I'm going to have that eyebrow lift up a little bit. Bit of a cranium suggestion in there. Looking at whatever's here, here's going to be his focal point. Some suggestion of an eyelid a little bit in there. Might be a little bit too far over to the right. Let's flip this. And that look of deep look of concentration. Centered. gonna give him smaller eyes too. I don't want his eyes to be too prominent. Give him a bit more of a gentle soul. The lower eyelid. Suggestion of a nose crease, but without actually painting the nose. Suggestion of a cheekbone in there. Don't want to go too far and make it look like he's got a nose bridge there, just a little bit. Concentration. If I'm thinking of the center of his face, it probably falls like this about, and it's going to have a deep brow. So if I wanted a shallow brow, I would make it put it here. I don't want to give him a deep brow, so the brow is going to go over to there. See, by moving the brow over, I'm giving him a deeper expression, a deeper eye socket, a little bit more masculine. I also want to give him a little accentuation of his smile because I'm wondering what kind of a creature he's going to be holding his hand. I want to really push the tenderness of this character. A suggestion of some wrinkles to give him age and character. I love old people, eh? Anybody, you know, I say this to my kids and to my wife and to my students and stuff like that. I'm always telling them, say, what are you looking forward to most in life? And my answer is always to get really old. I love old people. I can't wait to be an old person. Just, you know, for so many reasons too, you know. The first is old people just stop giving a shit at a certain point, you know. You know, bills and kids and, you know, work and taxes and stress note over every little thing, and old people are like, peh. My grandma, that was a very Polish thing. You know, if you have Polish grandparents, you'll probably relate to what I'm saying right now. You know, we're all gonna die. There's an earthquake. We're all gonna die. This is the end of the world. I don't know what I'm gonna do. I love you. And my grandmother's answer was always, peh. Yeah, I remember once I was sleeping over at a friend's house when I was younger. I was probably in my late teens or something like that. And his house was just down the street from just around the street from my grandmother's house. And at one point, my friend comes bursting into the room and says, "Adam, I think your grandmother's house is burning down." I was like, "What?" So I jumped out. I jumped up and I ran out the front door. And sure enough, I look and I can see that the side of my grandmother's house, there's definitely some kind of a fire going on, and it's coming from what looks like to be like the side of my mother's house. So I ran over to her house. There's a bunch of people outside checking it out, and what happened is the shed in her backyard had caught fire. It was up in flames, you know, flames shooting like 30 feet up in the air. So I ran into the front door of her house and I said, "Grandma, you've got to get out of the house. You're because what I noticed is there was a tree branch that there was a tree, a big tree, that was right over the shed, and it was touching the roof of her house, something she probably should have had cut down a long time ago. And she's in her kitchen, watching the fire, washing her dishes. I said, "Grandma, you've got to get out of the house, you're going to die." "Peh." I wanted to get, I swear to God, to this day, she couldn't care less, and she kept washing her dishes, and I was like totally freaking out on her, and she's like, "Eh, don't worry about it." You know, an 85-year-old woman at the time, she lived to 99, actually, and just short of her 100th birthday, too. But she couldn't care less, you know. She'd been through the Second World War, and, you know, she'd seen all kinds of crap out of her. Like, you know, I was just being a big, as the expression in Polish goes, a big histeryczka, an old, whiny, complaining woman, you know. Yeah, histeryczka. She kept washing her dishes. And it, sure enough, it burnt to ash, and she never even left her kitchen. She couldn't even care less. That's my grandmother for you. Real tough chick. Again, oh, sorry, that was the noise again. character in there. Kindness in the face. See, this is what I love about old people. They just have the such beautiful kind, well, when they're nice, not when they're assholes. But, because yes, ladies and gentlemen, old people can be assholes too. But, not this guy. He's a nice guy. He's a good guy. I always love people like that, you know, like Italians, you know. So, you know, he's got his but his whole he's had a buddy his whole life. They've been friends for like 80 years, you know. Like, my neighborhood's full of Italians. Italians and Jews. I'm surrounded by Italians and Jews. And you know, my landlord Mario, he's a really nice guy. We get along really well. And you know, he's the type of guy, he'd have a friend of the family's who's been fr they've been friends for like 7 years. They go back 7 generations, you know. And it's like, oh wow, you've been friends for a long time. You must be really, really close. Yeah, he's a nice guy. You know? They're very unemphatic, you know? They're very, yeah, nice guy. Like him. You know, saved my daughter once from a burning building. Nice guy. Not me, I'm the opposite. You know? The type of guy who'd be like, oh, sweetest guy in the world. He saved my daughter. I owe him my life. Oh, such a wonderful person. Him, nice guy. I always laugh about that kind of stuff. Yeah. I remember watching Lord of the Rings documentaries and stuff, and I can't remember what his name. The guy who plays Merry? Pip. I think he plays Pip. I can't remember his name. Really funny guy. You know, I love him. And he's talking about how, you know, in New Zealand, people always downplay stuff, you know. Oh, so you've won 7 Academy Awards. How do you feel about that? Ah, that's great. That's great. You know, really nice. I'm very happy to hear that. Yeah, it turned out great. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Inside, it's like, holy shit, I can't believe I won an Academy Award. You know, but outside, when he talks to press, he's like, yeah, it's good stuff. See, I'm not going to give him teeth or anything like that because I don't want him to look, menacing or anything like that. I want a nice, kind smile. Emphasize those cheekbones, the smile around his eyes. Give him a lot of warmth and compassion in his face. See, I'm suggesting a lot of human anatomy without actually making him look human. I'm injecting human anatomy into his character just to make him. Just so that we can identify with them, right? The face is a very important element. It's one of the reasons why, when, like, for instance, my students are working on, I mentioned in one of the earlier videos that my students are working on designing movie posters. I'm teaching image integration, digital image integration right now. Kind of stuff you'd learn for doing matte painting and stuff, right? And one of the criteria for the assignment is for them to they have to take live photo shoots in a studio. With Denis Roy, the all around extremely talented teacher who teaches all kinds of stuff, you know. One of the courses that he teaches is photography and cinematography. He teaches how to set up lighting studios and stuff like that, green screen, all that cool stuff. And one of the criteria for an assignment, because we're doing it together, is doing this movie poster using actual photos, right? Photos taken from the arts, from the actual light studio. And a lot of the students had asked me, you know, can I just, you know, kind of use it? Can I draw something instead? And I said, no. The whole reason why we're using it, we have to take a photograph of somebody's face, is because, and preferably the face of somebody else, is because it, it's a very important selling point when it comes to media. You know, you watch a, you know, one of the biggest reasons why people go out to watch a film is because of the actor that's in it, right? The quality of an actor says a lot about what it can very often tell you a lot about what to expect from the film. So that's why faces are very important. Now his gaze. A little too low, I think so. I think instead of moving his head, I'm gonna There's the noise again. Move his arm down. Yeah, because I think his arm is a little bit too short on the top, so extension. Now he's looking. His eye line is a little bit better. So far we're at around 50 minutes, so we're around 50 minutes into the painting, and we're moving forward nicely. I think we've got a good foundation. We're starting to delve into detail. I'm thinking to complete this, it'll probably take a couple of hours. Unless I really want to nerd out and push this design further and add more detail and stuff like that. But because I'm not worrying so much about color in this piece, it's allowing me to just think about form and value and texture, surface quality, stuff like that instead. It kind of saves time. But there are certain details, like I'd like to integrate it, maybe some moss, some little woodland creatures or insects floating around. I'm kind of like, my head is, I'm kind of thinking of the tier 15, tier 15 druid armor design for World of Warcraft. Actually, I think there's a few that are. Get ready for a sound. Oh, good, it didn't happen. Some beautiful character design for druids in the Mists of Pandaria expansion. Although I'm really not happy about the expansion. I really didn't like it. The whole Kung Fu Panda ripoff idea really didn't do it for me. Really didn't. Found a lot of the content was really just unexciting. So I think that's why for Warlords of Draenor they decided to really get back into the Warcrafty feel of it and bring in a darker theme. The whole it was getting a little bit too kiddy for a lot of people, you know. Now I understand that a lot of their clientele, a lot of their gamer base are is a younger audience, but you can't base an entire game around that. I found it was just too kiddy for me. I really didn't care for it too much. I mean, it was good. It wasn't the end of the world, but it was a very unexciting patch. There was a lot of time between design. But of course, I'm not hating on Blizzard for taking a long time to release Draenor update info, because I have a strong feeling that because of there was a lot of complaints that came in on Draenor, that they decided to kind of hit the drawing board again and redesign a lot of things and rebuild themes. So my guess is they put a lot of thought and consideration into how they did Draenor. For me, if one of the things that's important to mention as a concept artist, designer, that kind of thing, when you work in the industry, it's very important to play. You know, for me, I play games, and you know, a lot of my friends kind of hate on me. You know, especially when I was working at EA, a lot of the guys that I worked with were like, "You play WoW? It's just fashion content. It's just a dress me up game," and there's a lot of truth to that. I mean. Yeah, I did agree to a certain degree, but not entirely. I mean, there's a lot of fun. There's a lot of content. It keeps you engaged, right? But for me, I'm an artist. So for me, I'm very attracted to games that have a very strong sense of design to it. Even for a game very dated like World of Warcraft, you don't need high-res images to enjoy good design. And it's really honestly design that has carried WoW this far, right? But for the same reason that I love the games like Diablo, for instance, you know, it's just it's got a cartoon mentality. I'm sure that a lot of the artists that work at Blizzard might have started in animation or something like that, because it very often has that kind of a feel to it, including Diablo too. You know, there's less of it in Diablo than there is in WoW, but there's something going on here I don't like with the art, but the sense of ambiance and mood and design and, you know, form that they have, it's very engaging. I love it. You know, I love Diablo for that. One of my favorite areas in Diablo is New Tristram, the opening scene. You know, it's just, if you actually just sit there in New Tristram, the new one at least, the new version of it, and just sit there and suck in the atmosphere, the smoke and the the very warm village, but with a very dark theme to it type of thing. It's very beautiful mood to it. Little, crows that kind of flutter off when you walk past them, and merchants and the blacksmith and all that. There's a beautiful sense of mood, and from an artistic perspective, that kind of stuff is very inspiring and is very useful for an artist to familiarize yourself with that kind of stuff. Yeah, there's something about this that's bugging me here, but the big but is, we all know that video games can suck your life away. And I remember one of the things I heard Feng Zhu mention years ago in one of his videos was that he always made a point of never playing longer than a very limited period of time, because then the whole addiction factor kicks in, right? And it's very true. It's very true, especially for games like World of Warcraft that constantly lead you from one event to the next. It's the type of game where you start off saying, "Oh, I'm just going to do this," and next thing you know, 7 hours later, you're still going through quests and stuff like that, it can really suck you in, and I'm no exception to the rule. I've, the periods in my life where I really just spent way too much time on them. Right? Of course, this was before I was a dad and all that stuff, or I was a dad, but I didn't have three kids running around my house. But don't get me wrong. Of course, I was always there for my kids, but I spent too much time on the game, and that affects your health. Physically, emotionally, the whole bit, it wears you out after a certain time. And what do you have to show for it after you finally got that carrot at the end of the stick, right? You finally get that piece of armor that you've been dying to get, or you finish that tier that you've been dying to get, or finish that achievement you've been dying to get through. And then what happens? You stop playing. And that's where it ends, right? You just go, well, there's nothing else to go for. There's no more goals to chase after. So you just quit playing, right? Or for some people, they just jump onto another game. And when I was working at EA, I mean, the level of addiction that you can sometimes see in certain players. I've never worked at Ubisoft, but I remember, I've been there many times. It's a studio. It's a big studio here in Montreal, and I know a lot of people that work there, have a lot of friends that work there. And I visited Ubisoft many times, and these guys would be spending all day working on designing video games. Modelers and programmers and animators and artists and you name it. And then what would they do on their lunch break? They would play video games. So they would never leave their desk. And I'm sitting there going, dang, man, that's really not healthy. These guys never see the sun, They see the sun for about 2 minutes between the time that they finish work and they head over to the, oh, sorry, there was the noise again. And they head over to the metro. Metro, by the way, in Quebec, meaning subway. That's what we call it here. But you know what I mean? And then they go home, and then they keep playing till 1 o'clock in the morning. And I'm like, shit, man, you keep doing that, and you're not gonna last past 40. You're gonna have a freaking heart attack. So that kind of stuff's not healthy for you. So I adopted that same attitude. If there's a new game coming out and I'm really excited about it, like Draenor is coming out, I might say, you know what, I'm going to spend 48 hours and I'm just going to go ape shit. I'm just going to just play for 2 days straight and burn myself out, and then I drop it and I get back to work, And it's a discipline that we all need to learn as professionals. You just can't spend all your time playing video games all the time. You don't need to anyways. As artists, you just need to experience the atmosphere, get an idea, get to know what the visual design style was of the game and stuff like that. And then you can move on and do your own stuff, and you've got all the information you need. You don't have to get that tier 15 set. You just go on Google and you look it up, man. That kind of stuff. So for me, I restrict my gaming to, a bare minimum to get what I need out of it, and then I just turn it off and I get back to work, Or I actually play with my kids. Take them out to the park, play games, have them kick the crap out of me, because that's what little girls and boys do to daddies. They like kicking the snot out of them all the time. You see what I'm doing here? I'm just basically breaking up the silhouette. and adding shapes and finding forms and, bringing out some kind of design out of this guy. Now this front area here is feeling too much like a shirt, right? So that's why I'm breaking up the silhouette. Sorry, when I cringe, it's because that noise went off, but I will definitely be editing that out. I gotta figure out what's making that happen. Webbing between his fingers. Normally your muscles would be there, right? Normally there would be skin folds there, but what I'm doing is I'm taking those, I'm d creating those muscles, but I'm taking the skin off so it can create these nice kind of strips of vine that connect one to the next, but it still remains with an incredible tree design and credible human anatomy. I'm creating an abstraction. I'm abstracting it, right? There's another cringe. And another one. Oh, God. God, that's hard on the ears. Okay. I'm going to be. I want to start adding some detail to his face. So, okay. That original one I can get rid of because I like where the face is going. I'm going to copy that. I always make a duplicate. Because I like working directly on the layer, because I like to cut out and paint over. You can't do that on two layers, so I usually just copy my image where I'm happy where it's ended off, and I paint from there. And if there's anything I don't like, I can just go back to my earlier version. And don't forget to save very often, because it's always those times that you get caught up in your work and you're all, you spend hours on it and it looks great. Oh, awesome. God, I love where this is going. And you completely lose track of the fact that you haven't saved in 2 hours and then poof, power goes out. Happens to me every frickin' time. There's a certain amount of paranoia that goes with being a concept artist or even worse, a 3D animator or modeler, Remember my first project working in 3D when I was teaching myself 3D. I never went to school for 3D, but I was learning Maya. I had a beginner's guide to Maya that kind of takes you through the entire production process and stuff like that. And the first lesson teaches you how to paint with NURBS. Yes, NURBS. Look it up. It exists. And I was painting with NURBS and, or not painting, but modeling with NURBS, which is a very, it's basically like modeling with Bezier curves instead of polygons. It's a very, very weight intensive way to work. I don't even know if people still use, I don't even know if NURBS exists. Well, subdivs are kind of subdivision surfaces are kind of a derivative of NURBS plus polygons type of thing, right? To create smooth forms when you're working in low res. But I had spent hours and hours and my first time because I'm learning while I'm doing it, right? I always like to learn on the job. Like I give myself a project and I learn in the process of trying to figure out how to do things because then you're learning in context, right? And I must have spent about 8 hours just sitting there. I wasn't breathing. I wasn't moving. Sorry about the dinging sound. Oi! As it's as another stand-up comedian would say, the hell's his name again? Oh, really funny guy, Jewish guy. He's on Netflix, and he goes, as Jewish people would say, OMG. Yeah, but I'm sorry about that dinging sound. I'm gonna try to figure it. I'm tr gonna try to fix it later on, but right now I'm halfway through a painting, so I don't feel like letting it go. I'm gonna put you through the torture of listening to this piercing ding every now and then. But yeah, I was probably talking about something else and went on a tangent, but I forgot, so screw it. I'll just keep painting. My little statuette. There you go. Come here, let me look at you closely. I'm looking at this facial detail. God, what a nice little sculpture. I'll take a picture of it after so you'll know which one I'm talking about. Okay. Just trying to look at where the facial detail is. He's got a little bit of a crease in his brow. Okay. I like that because it's really nice. There's a real, really nice expression going on in his face. Want to capture a little bit of that in my character. Getting that right? I'm trying to catch that fold between his eyes, the crease of his nose. Show a little bit more concentration. I'd love to meet the guy that sculpted this little guy. He probably, it's kind of the type of sculpture you can imagine this guy kind of like sculpts like 250 of these a day, you know? So he's kind of like just very repetitive work, but there's just so much skill involved in this little, simple little sculpture that I love. I'd love to, I wish I could track him down. Let me see if there's a name on the bottom of this or something. Oh, there's something there. China. Yeah, no, that doesn't help. I don't see a name. Oh well, I guess we'll never know. It's funny. Reminds me of a story once. I was in New York at one point. I went to New York for a trip. I went on a little trip, and I went to some club on Broadway, and I'm smoking a cigarette. Right? Yes. Okay. I'm a smoker. Leave me alone. And I'm smoking a cigarette, and some girl who sees me there, she sees me smoking, and I guess she saw me pull out my pack, and it was a pack of Du Maurier cigarettes, which is Quebec. It's a Quebec brand of cigarettes. And I swear to God, I'm not kidding you. She says to me, she walks up to me, and she goes, "Oh my God, you're smoking Du Maurier's?" And I said, "Yeah. Do you know Chris?" And I was like, "What?" Okay, give me an address. Give me a freaking province at least. You know, she didn't even, you know, she's like, "You know Chris?" I said, "You realize that there's more than 14 people living in Canada, right? Just throwing it out there." You know, no last name or nothing. She just, "Do you know Chris?" And of course, my smart-ass answer was, "Oh yes, of course, he's living four igloos down from me." What the kind of a stupid question is that, you know? Oi. OMG. Yeah. I said, "No, you know, I don't know Chris. Maybe if you give me a last name, that might help, but you know." Eesh. Sorry for the ding. Mirwan, this is an awesome suggestion. I'm having a lot of fun with this guy. Now, what I'm going to do, by the way, just to give you a little heads up, is what I plan on doing with this is I have, if you check out my gallery page on my on the website, you're going to notice that I have two sections. One of them is for fine art and environments. The other one is for character development, kind of more fantasy creature design type of thing. And I wasn't quite sure what to do with that third section, but I knew I wanted to have a third section. That's why I designed it that way. And, or at least I didn't change the design of the template. And I decided that that third section is going to be where I post work from the forum, from forum suggestions. So, and credit will go to you, Mirwan, for suggesting it, for sure, because it's your idea, the one who gave me the idea to do it. So. I really appreciate it, man. It was a really good idea because I'm really enjoying this, and I'm definitely, it's definitely a piece I'm gonna feel very proud to show off to people, you know. But please do make like. Confirm or deny that I am pronouncing your name properly because I really don't wanna, I completely hate not getting names right. It's like newscasters. I remember there was a comedian who was talking about newscasters. You ever notice that newscasters, when they're telling the news, when they talk about a different country, all of a sudden they become a person from that country, you know? It's like. And in other news, down in Puerto Rico, you know, Jose Fernandez had trouble with his cat, so blah, 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 blah. He all of a sudden becomes somebody from that nationality. You know, it's funny. I do it too. I think a lot of us are guilty of doing that stuff. Because you don't want to sound white when you're talking about other things. You know, you don't want to sound like a, you know, a North American or a Canadian. Eh? By the way, a little heads up for all of y'all out there that think that all Canadians talk like this, eh? You know, like we're not all Rick Moranis, all right? Just be aware, please. You know, not all Canadians talk like this, eh? You know, when I was walking down the street, I went to get some bacon at the store, you know, and I saw Richard, eh? You know Richard? Richard the bartender? And he was like, "Hey, how are you doing, Adam, eh?" No. In fact, I don't know if I've ever met anybody who spoke like that. Maybe in the prairies or the Maritimes. Well, in the Maritimes, it's mostly Newfie accents. Yeah, somebody who does a very funny Newfie accent is Jim Carrey in *Lemony Snicket*. Come where I am, and I'll be where you're at. That's right. I met her. How's that song go again? It's a funny song. I can't remember. I'm gonna ruin the lyrics to the song, but it's something like, "I think you met my daughter. You found her by the water. That's when I floundered down her. That's why they never found her." Kind of Maritime very often has like Newfie accents have a very Irish influence to it. There's always that, always resonates a little bit of Irish in there. Come where I am and I'll be where you're at. I love that. It's funny. My ex-girlfriend's parents were from Newfoundland, very Newfie from Champanese West, and man, they had an accent, but it didn't sound anything like, you know, that Rick Moranis thing. It's nothing like that. I'm really not sure where that accent comes from, to be honest with you. To be honest with you know, maybe I should just talk like a Canadian just for fun. Oh, I'm gonna add a little bit of a detail to him, eh? You know, make him look more like a tree, you know? Oh, look at that. Well, you know, actually, who does talk like that a little bit? Keep forgetting the term that they use. They keep changing the damn term. On the reserve, on the Indian reserve, but not—they're not freaking Indian. But First Nations people, they have a bit of an accent like that. I can see that, but that's not, you know, a strictly Canadian accent. And then you have Quebec, because I live in Montreal, right? So it's a mélange of English and French. And very often you get very, very used to hearing English people speak with a French accent and French people speaking with a English accent. Or sorry, French people speaking English with a French accent and English people speaking French with an English accent. Like if I wanted to say something like I don't know, like I'm not gonna say voulez-vous de beurre. I'm not Fred Savage here, but I'd probably say something like what would I say? You know, if I want to say like hi, how are you? You know, the very general thing you learn at the beginning. You know, like in English, you'd say hi, how are you? In French, you'd say bonjour, comment ça va? But an Anglophone who's got a strong accent would probably say something like bonjour, comment ça va? You know, something like that. They butcher it, right? Well, the same thing with the Quebecers. You know, French Quebecers when they speak English, they have funny habits that I'm always making fun of my friends. You know, like where the hell, why do you guys do that? I don't know where that comes from. Like how you got the habit of doing, like for instance, they will add H's where there are none, especially when they follow a vowel. So if you have like my name, Adam. French people are always screwing up my name. So instead of saying Adam, they say Hadams, Hadams, right? And they add an S to the end of my name. They all do. And I was actually, for years, I didn't know what the hell they were talking about. Like, why do Francophones always put an S at the end of my name? There's no S. It's Adam. It's not Adams, right? And one of my friends actually might have answered that for me. She says, well, maybe it comes from the Adams family. I was like, oh, that would make sense, you know? Because I never knew why the hell they did that. But they'll add H's where there are none. Hadam, right? Hadams. Or I'm very, I want to eat the apple, okay? And or they will take away an H where there is. I'm very happy to eat this apple. You tell me what that's all about, you know? Of course, Anglophones are even worse than that. When they try to speak French, it's like, dang, man, you just sound like a moron, dude. But it doesn't matter. In Quebec, we don't really care about that stuff. Don't listen to what they say on politics. Most people don't give a crap. Yeah. As long as you're, making an effort to communicate, stuff like that, then nobody cares. Everybody's level of vocabulary in Quebec is different, and nobody gives a shit. I mean, I'm an Anglophone and I teach French. I teach in French, right? I teach at a French college. It's my home away from home, in my opinion, some of the best people on earth. I love them to pieces. So if you're my student and you're listening to me right now, I love you. You're awesome. Don't ever change. You make me very happy. Okay? Yeah, there was this girl, Martine, who used to live across the street from me. There was a family, Martine, Annie, and Julie, or Annie, Julie, and Martine. We see, Martine is a very Anglophone way of saying the name Martine. It's a French name. And this one girl used to, she hated my guts, and she used to say, Hadams, you stupid, crazy hassle. That's what she used to call me all the time. I probably earned that title too. I'll tell you a little story. I probably shouldn't tell you this, but well, what the heck? You got nothing better to do. You're watching me paint, right? But I was into ninjas when I was a kid. God, this is a terrible story. I don't know why I'm sharing this with you. I was really into ninjas, like Revenge of the Ninja and all those cool movies. I was a total nerd for that kind of stuff when I was a kid, and as most boys my age were at the time. And I think ninjas are actually kind of starting to make a comeback type of thing. But I was all into ninjas and stuff, and I had fashioned this. My mother had bought me this, one of those cheap plastic dart sets, for my room. And I had I my poor mom, come to think of it, Jesus, if my kids did this, I'd have a freaking heart attack. But I fashioned this. I had kind of one of those school bags that tie up, like it has this drawstring, so it ties up into like a sphincter type knot. And I used it as a kind of a dart quiver. I must have been, I don't know, like 8 or 9 or something like that. Old enough to play with darts at least, right? And I wasn't a little kid, but and I had my dartboard in my room, and my mother had no idea I was doing this. She almost passed out when she saw it. But I had I had my dartboard on the other side of the room, and I kind of shoved like a handful of darts into this kind of closed off drawstring bag, so I could kind of reach over my back and pull them out. And I had this idea that, how would a ninja throw a dart? And I thought, well, ninjas would probably throw darts like by just t pulling it out of their, pulling it out of their quiver and whoop, shooting it immediately. So I'd kind of like shoot these arcing shots towards my dartboard, and 90% of them missed. And I did this for hours and hours and hours and hours until my walls were completely riddled with little dart holes. Okay? Yeah. A mother's nightmare. And my mother came in the room and says, what the beep, 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 beep did you do to your walls? Needless to say, I lost my dartboard pretty fast after that. I was shoved that dartboard up my ass, but but yeah. So, but in the case with Martine, she was the Adam, you stupid, crazy hassle, And I had one of my ninja concoctions, be it my ninja star that I fashioned out of a triangular kind of one of those I don't know what they're called, but it's like a kind of an engineer's ruler thing. It's a triangular shape for getting right angles and 45 degree angles and stuff like that. And I had cut that up into little ninja stars and threw it up against a cardboard box outside in my front yard. But in this particular case, I had my little dart concoction thing, my dart quiver concoction thing that I had fashioned, and she was standing on this kind of like ledge, standing on the grass. She was about, I don't know, 10 feet away from me, and she was, "Ha damn, you stupid crazy hassle." And I went, "Oh yeah? Well, ninja attack!" And I grabbed one of the darts out of my thing, and I boom, threw it up in the air, but straight up in the air. It could have hit me in the head, I shot it about 40 feet in the air, like boom, shot it up in the air, and she's just standing there. She's taunting me. And I'm like, "Oh shit, where's this gonna land? I'm gonna be in so much trouble if this hits her." And sure enough, she's in the middle of nah, 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 and it goes right into the bottom of her foot, right into the top of her foot. I shit you not, this is a true story. I'm not making this stuff up. I couldn't make it up. And it goes right into her foot, and she just stops. She just like freeze frames all of a sudden. She's just sitting there, and she looks at me, and I can see the tears welling up in her eyes, and I'm thinking, "I'm in so much shit." And she just starts to bawl, and she runs down the street to her mom's house, and she's screaming, "Mommy, mom," in French. She's screaming, basically saying, "Dad, mommy, Adam threw a dart in my foot." And her mom comes out, and she's just red in the face. "You did this? You did this to my daughter? You psycho!" So I was blacklisted from hanging out with her daughters for probably a good 6 months after that event happened. Oi, that was not a good. That was some damn. Yeah. So now you know. I wasn't a perfect kid. How I turned out to be such a geezer, I have no idea, because I was a real shit disturber when I was a kid. Of course, this is great too, because my daughters might listen to this, or my son might listen to this later on and say, "Oh, I can get away with shit. I don't have to be perfect." Oh yeah, another thing I did once was, God, I'm setting myself up for disaster telling you these stories. Not because of you per se, but because of what this is going to backfire with my kids eventually, when they're old enough to know, to realize what I'm teaching them. Lucas, Chloe, Emily, if you listen to this, don't do this. This is very stupid. But there was this guy down the street, this Italian family down the street, where his son was kind of like the street bully, because I used to, back before internet existed, kids used to actually go outside and play, right? And this kid down the street was a real bully, and his father was like, we called him the Italian Nazi, because he had a Hitler stash, and he was just a real mean bastard. And we decided one day, actually, no, I'm mixing up stories. This didn't actually happen to him. I did something else to his car. Wow, really? The shit's hitting the fan today. But he had my mother's friend had this nice car, and I can't remember who I was doing it with, maybe with her daughter, because I was friends with her daughter. And I had a nail, like a nail to nail into the wall type of thing, and I thought it would be a cool idea to play tic-tac-toe with this nail by scratching tic-tac-toes into the hood of her car. So she gets, I wasn't th I didn't think it. I was too stupid to know I was doing anything wrong, I think. Yeah, I'm pretty positive I was too stupid to know what I was doing. If I knew what I was doing, I wouldn't have done it. Of course, I was a young kid, but in any case, I play the game with I guess with my friend, and then a couple of hours pass, and then my doorbell rings, and Kathy, my mother, my friend's mom was with the door, and she's and you can cross-reference this shit. I'm telling you this. I'm telling you the truth here. She comes knocking on the door, and she said, I hear them talking at the front door, and then I hear my mother say, "Adam, come here." I was like, "Oh, what did I do now?" And I walk up, and my mother says, "Did you play tic-tac-toe on Kathy's car with a nail?" I said, "Yeah." She goes, "Adam, she's gonna have to repaint her whole car now." I said, "Oh, is that bad?" She goes, "Yeah, that's very bad. It's very expensive to fix that." I'm so sorry, I didn't know, So yeah, grounded again. Jeez. The other one was the other jeez. Here we go. The other one was that talking about that kid, that bully kid's father on the street. That guy was a psychopath, man. I mean, I do feel bad for what I did, but still, like the guy was a real meanie. Even to this day, I still agree that this guy was a real mean guy. He hated the kids on the street, and he had this dog, that just it was just this evil thing. I was always afraid to walk down the street because I would cross paths with this dog, It's just mean, vicious thing. You knew if you got over the fence, you were finished. Kind of like that story from like that movie there, back in the. Sorry about the ding. Not Stand By Me. Is it Stand By Me? I think it might have been Stand By Me. With River Phoenix and all those guys and stuff. That Chomper, Sick Balls. Well, I had one of those on my street. One of those mean dogs. These mean, vicious dogs. I can't remember. Maybe Pit Bull or something like that. I can't remember. But I'm talking and I'm drawing, so it's slowing me down quite a bit. But yeah, anyways, this guy, I was my friend Billy lived up just a couple of houses up from me, and I was on Billy's porch, and we thought it would be a cool idea to pick tomatoes off of his tree, which was right off of his porch. You could reach them from his porch, and throw them in the air and whip them at the tree, which was strategically placed right over that mean guy's baby blue car. This car was his, the only thing I think in the world he ever had any compassion for. And we whipped them at the tree, and what it did was it sprayed tomato guts all over his car. Now this was deliberate. I just wanted to mess up his car because I didn't like him. But I was a good kid, by the way. Just so you don't get the wrong impression here, I was a nice kid. I just did stupid stuff sometimes. I think as a lot of boys do. But in any case, I digress. So we both, picked tomatoes. It must have been about 20 or 30 tomatoes, and we just whipped them at his car, whipped them at the tree, and enjoyed watching them splatter all over, the Italian Nazi's car, right? So we did it, and then giggled and walked away, and then again, my doorbell rings, and this time it's not Kathy. This time it's the evil Italian guy down the street, and I hear him just cursing and screaming and everything like that. I knew I did something wrong, but I didn't know to what extent I had done something wrong. And I hear him, "Bring your son to me. I want to see your son. Bring him to me. I'm going to kill him." And my mother's like, "You better calm your ass down, man, because you ain't going anywhere near my kid, He's like, "I'll kill him. I'll kill him. I swear to God, I'll kill him." This is what he keeps saying, and I'm sitting there. I'm in my room, and I'm just going pale. I'm like, "Oh shit, I'm dead." Of course, my mother didn't let him come anywhere near me because he probably would have kicked my ass. But in any case, what had happened was it's tomatoes, and I didn't know. Hey, when you're a 7-year-old or 6-year-old kid, you don't know that tomatoes contain a lot of acid, and it ate up all the paint on his car. And so basically he turned his pride and joy baby blue Ford into what looked like it had been tie-dyed by some 18-year-old high school girl, had white blotches all over it. Oh, not good. Not good. Not proud of that. Yep, so I really have no idea why I'm sharing these stories with you. It just seemed to be where the conversation was heading, so yep. I was a real shit disturber. That's why, when people ask me, "Why do you have a Calvin tattoo on your shoulder?" Oh, there's your answer. That was kind of like what I was like when I was a kid. And I like Calvin because as a kid, I really identified with that character. So when I'm talking about Calvin, I'm talking about Calvin and Hobbes, by the way. One of my favorite all-time comic books. I love it. That and Garfield were the two ones that I liked to read the most when I was a kid. And it fills me with pride and joy that my 13-year-old daughter is a huge Garfield fan. And I got her a Calvin and Hobbes book, and she started to get into it too. It's just, it's just, happy times. Big smiles. All right, we're noodling around a lot. Kind of slowing things down quite a bit. I want to keep this video under 2 hours if I can, so I'll try to get this fleshed out. It's going to be, I'm not going to color it. I'm just going to keep it as a value painting, but I want to at least have this fleshed out to a certain degree. So let's just suggest some anatomy in his fingertips. So normally I'd be a little bit more concentrated. I don't have a huge amount of practice painting and talking at the same time. It is kind of distracting. You kind of find yourself just sitting there doodling, doodling, doodling. But I think I did okay. I did okay. It's not the end of the world. Like an old Polish guy would say, you could do worse. Oh, that actually sounds more Jewish. You could do worse. A little bit more value, so you can see that transition a bit better. They never compliment you. They just let you know that worse things on earth that do exist, so don't feel so bad, you spend like 6 months working on a painting, I'd imagine, like King's Harem, a painting I spent, on and off 6 months working on. It was a big project, and I unveil it for the first time. And I look at, I'm making up some imaginary old Jewish guy, and I show it to him and I go, "What do you think?" He looks at it, "Eh, you could do worse." "Gee, thanks." Be a two-fingered fella, but I still have to get that anatomically. I still have to stay true to what actual human hand anatomy looks like, right? I can't just give him these weird-looking stumps. Well, it has to make some kind of a sense to it, right? So, I'm borrowing from human anatomy, from my knowledge of human anatomy to render this out. Just a touch. I'm going to show that this finger's overlapping the thumb. And I don't want to go too crazy with it because I do want to, this his entire body, his entire being is created from the same material, right? So I'm not changing that up at all. Oh, by the way, happy Halloween, everybody. Completely forgot. I'm taking my little kids out trick-or-treating today. It's going to be fun. A lot of fun. I love Halloween. My favorite holiday. My absolute favorite holiday. I love the mood. When I think of Halloween, I think of the Charlie Brown Halloween special. Something about that pumpkin patch scene that just is so evocative. It really puts you in the Halloween spirit. It's got this really good Halloweeny feel to it. I love that. I can't say I'm a huge Charlie Brown fan, but I definitely love that. It was a special when I was a kid that really resonated with me. I love trick-or-treaters. The only thing that sucks is that on the street that I live on, it's on a bit of a crescent street, so no kids come down here. My wife and I set up this whole, we got all the candies and we had all the decorations and the pumpkins and everything like that. We're all set up and had everything. We must have had two trick-or-treaters show up the whole night. I was like, "Damn, man, that was such a disappointment." So this year we know for this year, we've known since that, we don't bother because none of the kids come down here. Instead, we just take the kids out for trick-or-treating and we take them out instead of. Because I would love to just stay at home and dress up in some spooky costume and watch those cute little kids show up at my door and give them treats. And 1 year, I know 1 year when we eventually move, when we end up moving, when we make plans to move and stuff like that, I want to move to an area where we can get trick-or-treaters because that kind of stuff's important to me. But I'm gonna be like the type of guy who, for one Halloween, who only gives out politically correct candy, like gluten-free rice treats, that kind of thing. What the hell is this? You suck. I want kids yelling "you suck" as they walk away down the street. And I, of course, will be dressed up as an old codger who doesn't give a shit. So my response when they say "you suck" is gonna be "yo mama." He's an asshole. Yeah. Least they gave you something. Sorry for the ding. Least you got something. Let's get this arm going. Negative space in here. Show the bones, like suggesting the bones of the arm, right? But crudely, loosely. I'm not being too anal about it. Show a little bit of roots that connect. Adopting anatomy from human anatomy and injecting it into these characters. Just where it need be, Certain areas is not necessary, but in there are other areas it's kind of important. Hell, a lot easier working with the basic round brush after you work with a slightly temperamental texture brush. A lot of those demons designs were created with a texture brush, so the blending was a little bit less, a little not as smooth as it is with the basic round brush. You can really move forward a lot more quickly with that. But I love the look that it ended up giving, so it was worth the struggle. It wasn't a huge struggle, but it's definitely a lot smoother working with the basic round brush. Add some detail because his hand is an important focal point, so I'm going to want to add some kind of a nice use of negative space and some added detail in his fingers to make them a little bit more interesting as a focal point. I'm giving him kind of fingernails to kind of add a bit of that tree-like silhouette shape to those fingertips. But I don't want to go as far as to make them look like they're thick, sharp, long fingernails. So I'm just kind of being a little bit careful about how I approach that. Looks okay. Yeah, that looks good. shoulder blade to kind of dip behind. Suggest that this shoulder kind of wraps around in the back. Just careful not to create any awkward tangents in that. Make sure it's clear that it's actually coming from his shoulder. And I'm making it darker so that your eyes can tell, so you can tell that it's actually in depth, it's in the shadow. It helps sell the idea that it's actually behind everything else, right? Adding a little bit more value to it. Thickness, a few more vines to show the connection. How's that look? Just don't want to create a tangent with this part here. I can overlap it. See, the reason I'm tipping this down, I'm leaning it downwards as opposed to pointing it up, I'm bringing it down, is to suggest that his shoulder blades, you see that his posture is very far back. He's got a good posture. So show that his posture, it suggests that his, those kind of, they're kind of indicative, they're kind of suggestive of his shoulder blades. So by pulling him back like that, I'm suggesting that he's flexing his back, giving him a tighter, a stronger back, a better posture. Gives him a little bit of elegance into his pose, right? That's good. That works. Yeah, a little, sorry about the ding. Just create a little bit of a visual connection between these two parts. Okay, now I can get rid of this original one. Originally, we were at this point before. Now we're here. Copy this one and try to finish this up soon because we're rounding up to 2 hours here, so I don't want to push that. It's going to be a hell to render. It takes a long time. I have an okay computer, I don't have a super computer. And, you know, videos that run this long generally really take a long time to render. Now, I'm thinking I might want to just fade out that hip girdle here. Though I want to do so suggesting a little bit of perspective there, because just cutting it off flat kind of doesn't make sense. Suggesting, you know, like he's, it's almost as if giving the illusion that he's standing in a cloud type of thing, right? That's a bit better. Yeah, I'll just keep it at that. That's a handy little feature in Photoshop CC. I like that feature a lot. Comes in very handy. Okay, now I want to add a little bit more depth to his eyes, just to darken them, just to create a better, a stronger focal point. But I'm going to keep them black, just to kind of suggest eye openings type of thing. So I'm going to create some depth to help create a stronger focal point, and around his mouth, kind of the opening there, right? Also helps emphasize his kind of smiling face. Sorry about the ding. Now, I'm not going apeshit and hyper-detailing everything in this piece because I do want to keep this piece a bit shorter, a bit quicker, right? It's definitely a piece that I can imagine myself pushing the detail of it, adding a lot more detail to it. Let me see here. Add a little character to this. Let's give him. He's not just fascinated with the palm of his hand. I want to actually give him, I want to have some little creature in there. And I'm thinking about a moth instead of a butterfly, but I'm actually thinking about a moth. And I kind of recently, a friend of mine posted a picture about she had seen this huge Luna moth on her. She was at her country place, and she took a picture of this. I mean, humongous, beautiful Luna moth on her screen window. She said apparently there was a lot of them. I like the idea of doing that. Do it in a way that it's clear to the. Oh, here, that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna create a kind of interaction between the two. Body standing there. They're very impressive looking insects, Luna moths. They're huge. And the whole kind of mystical kind of aspect about it really sells the whole magical feel, right? Little bit more contrast. Kind of matching the values that I have here, right? And the focal areas all have a slightly darker value and more contrast. Clip mask it and let's throw a little light in on this. Go a little lighter though. I want it to be a lighter value than that. The nutrient. Some subsurface scattering, higher value. this light, I'm going to make it brighter. I'm going to sharpen his wings by creating a thinner line here. It's too thick, it's going to look like he's got these fat wings, right? I'm going to keep that. That rim shadow thin to suggest the thinness of his wing tips. Here, because it's against a darker surface, I'm going to raise the value even more. Because it's not against a white background, so it'll be evident. And here, because Luna Moth's body is a little bit lighter, I'm going to add a little bit of a lighter value here. Actually, there's an important detail here that I can't leave out. His tail and his wings are actually connected. Tricky. It's a very specific shape that I'm looking for here. To make it look convincing. Think maybe the torso is a bit big, so I'm going to actually flatten this and scale this body down ever so slightly. Wings a little bit more impressive. then I cheat because I can. Don't judge me. Change it up just a little bit so that it's less evident that this is a copy paste. And this outer wing is going to have a little bit more light coming through it because the, as far as subsurface scattering is concerned, the first, this wing is casting a bit, is blocking some of the light. Even if there's a bit of a transparency, it's blocking some of the light for the second wing. So add a little bit more, a little slightly higher value to there to show there's a bit more light coming through. Illusion, remove a shadow. Place it somewhere where it creates a strong silhouette. Now I could make this Luna Moth kind of proportion. That's actually relatively proportionate to how they would be sitting on a human's hand, so you can actually kind of get an idea of how the scale of this type of moth. However, I want this, I think it's a little, it's a little bit, I don't know. I'm curious to see what it'll look like if he's a little smaller than that. Actually, just inverse my selection, add a little bit more shading here at this part of the body. Full out of. Don't erase your moth. Now I gotta actually give this moth appendages. Because as it stands right now, it's just this blob with no legs. So I'm just gonna add some little legs to the guy. Little hooks to show where his feet are touching the hand. About the surface that he's standing on, right? It's important. It's got to be in perspective with the hand, with the roundness of his hand. Show a little bit of a bump here, right there, to show that he's so that it's actually connected to his body. I'm going to add a little bit of detail here on the body. This is all taken from reference, but oh, reference here. Yes, I'm using reference. Here's your reference right there. Just Luna Moth. It's not that hard. Nothing specific. I think Luna Moth, I draw Luna Moth. He's not complicated. Right? Right. He's very good. He's very good. Very. Yes. Very good. Okay. Movie aficionados out there. Oh, what the hell? People who know movies well. I'm going to do an impression very poorly, and you try to figure out what movie this is from. If you know your movies well, then you'll get it. That's very good. That is very good. Where's that from? There's a hint. It's a comedy, hopefully. And it's a comedy, and it probably came out in the 1990s, I think. It's a parody movie. It's like kind of like a Naked Gun type of movie. But it's not Naked Gun. It's something else. Oh, I'm going to go lighter here. It's not Naked Gun, but it's one of those types of spoof movies, right? Like Naked Gun and Airplane and that kind of thing. Let's see if you can figure that out. If you find out, if you know where that's from, then just leave your answer in the on the forum. Show that these are antenna and not more feet. Almost done here. Let's give them a face. Give them those fancy schmancy antenna that those Luna Moths like to show off so much. So I'm going to do it like this, I think. I'm just trying to think of the way it would be easiest and quickest to do it. Make sure I'm on another layer. This color, light on dark, dark on light, right? And then I shall just come in with my eraser and give it that kind of leafy design here. Let's rotate this around a little bit so it'll make it a bit easier to get these nice lines. It's not easy working pixel. My eyes are going bonky. Going in the wrong direction here. That's good, that's good, that's good. I'm going to start to rotate. Might be a bit redundant and boring to watch me painting these little lines and stuff like that. Oof, this is optically really hard on my eyes. Probably because I've been staring at my screen for such a long time, but geez. Oof. Which is kind of cool. That's actually doing that. But this kind of a pattern is important. This kind of texture is important because it's very good for creating a focal point, right? Because it's an interesting pattern. If you want to sound cultured, I'll teach you a little something in French. In Quebec, I don't know if this is an expression that actually if it exists in France as well. There's two different types of French, of course. They have a lot of different expressions. But a common expression in Quebec is when you want to say you did something by hand, right? If you did something by hand, like I did it by hand, I didn't use digital tricks. You know, if somebody was to ask me in French, like, did you use what digital tricks did you use to do this? I would say, I didn't use digital tricks, I did it by hand, right? In French, the expression for I did it by hand, what is à la mitaine? À la mitaine. À la mitaine means mitaine means mittens. À la means by the mittens. So it's like a cute way of saying I did it with my bare hands, but instead you say mittens. À la mitaine. So if next time you're speaking to your friends and stuff like that, you go, what kind of tricks did you do that? Oh no, I just, how do they say in France? À la mitaine. You know, you can say it like that. People will think you're all hoity-toity. See, in Quebec, nobody gives a shit if you say something like that. But if you go somewhere where people don't speak the language, you can say people think you're all fancy. You'll have fans and paparazzi surrounding you 24 hours a day. Okay, sounds good. Just gonna edge up the shape a little bit, refine it. Because on the Lunamos, as I can see in my reference, it kind of tapers in, creates a little bit, kind of a leafy tip. It's very pretty. Pretty little thing, huh? Got to keep that overall shape. That's nice. Isn't that? It's very nice. I like it very much. It's very good. It's very good. I'm very tempted to say which film I've got that from, but much rather leave you guys guessing. Torture you poor souls. It's very good. I could give you another clue, but I'm afraid that I would be giving too much away. I play these kinds of games with my daughter, with my 13-year-old all the time. You know, we'll quote something or something. And say, what movie is that from? And she's really good at those things. She's very good at creating clues that are really difficult, but you're sure you know it from somewhere, you know? And she's really good at doing that kind of stuff. But I'm afraid if I give you one more clue, I'm going to be giving it away. And it's, oops, sorry for the ding. Just how many of those bloody dings am I gonna have to put you through before I do something about it? I'm gonna change the sound scheme on my computer so that it doesn't play it. Or I might even be able to disable that sound because it's frickin' ugh. Especially in my earphone, I'm using a headset right now to record, and it's good sound, right? So that sound really just hits you right in the bladder. It's, ugh, God, it's terrible. That's not what I wanted to do. Good Lord. Hey, he looks very. You see? He's an Italian. This is an Italian treant. He said, hey, he's very good. You're a very good, very, very good mutt. I like you. You're very good. Okay. I got to finish this up soon. Just let me see if I can track down my other reference. Oh, yeah, I needed the face. I need those nice big eyes. Very curious to know more about Tim Burton's new film coming out, Big Eyes. I saw it. I was like, kind of, well, that's interesting. The artistry behind it is very curious. But I have faith. He's a great director. I mean, it doesn't mean I love all of his stuff equally. There's some stuff I like more than others, of course. I'm sure everybody feels the same way. Some of the movies he came out with, I was kind of like, eh. But then he's a good example of, a lot of people see him as a movie director, but he's also very inspiring, I find, as an artist. You know, his particular style and his approach to it is, a lot more, from a designer's perspective, is a lot more. It deserves more credit than sometimes it gets. Everybody loves Tim Burton's style, and he's got these cute little drawings, but those silly little drawings that he does are actually, there's a lot of skill. I'm pretty sure he comes from an animation background himself too, but those drawings he does are really well done. There's an incredible sense of style and mood, and if you don't believe me, try doing it yourself. Try imitating his style. It's not as easy as it looks. So I have a lot of respect for that guy's work. But Big Eyes, I'm very curious. I saw that and I saw the kind of the posters for it and everything. I'm like, that's curious. I don't know what to think of that. But the whole fact that he's kind of doing something that appears to be a little bit out off the mold, is really sparking my curiosity. I'm very curious to see where he goes with that because it means he's on to something. And I like it when directors are on to, I like it when directors have balls, when they're not afraid to, when they're not afraid to try something different. A lot of directors kind of get, they get harassed for that. Why did you produce this? Why did you make this crap? It sucks. You're not as good as you used to be. No, I don't feel that way at all about directors. For a director to be well known for producing a certain style and then totally go experimental and it's kind of like an artist starting from scratch, that shows a hell of a lot of ambition. Like how many people gave Peter Jackson shit for the fact that he did it in 3D. If he shot The Hobbit in 3D. I didn't see the 3D version of it, but people were just coming down on it. And yeah, sure, it's very possible that it's really hard on the eyes, that it's a little bit too realistic and all that stuff. But that doesn't take away from the fact that a guy who's got it all wasn't afraid to say, let's try something out. Let's see if this works or not. That to me, I really respect that. Of course, the public aren't always that forgiving when it comes to that kind of stuff. They're very, it's kind of like the, like in Shrek the Third, where the little boy who keeps saying, "Do the roar," right? And Shrek's like, "I don't like doing the roar. Do the roar." Yeah, that's kind of, I kind of see pu the public that way sometimes. When it comes to doing certain types of things, people can be really, they don't allow when some when somebody gets a kind of their niche style or their niche market, and then. They try to step outside the box. People can be very unforgiving about that kind of stuff. Somebody's kind of like, give the poor guy a break, man. He's a brave soul for being able to try something out. People kind of forget the fact that this guy's an artist and this guy's he's learning. He's still learning. He's not the god of film. He's a guy who's extremely talented at what he does, and he's decided to give it a shot doing something different. And if it doesn't work, he's actually willing to take a chance. And you got to respect that, man. You really do. You can't be so hard on these poor guys. Where's his eyes? His eyes need to be a little closer together. But that's what they're saying, a lot of artists say that. A lot of well-known artists say that. They say life doesn't stop when you get that gig. Life, your career starts when that happens. That's when the real hard work happens because, I'll give you a perfect example. I paint stuff all the time, every day, but I don't paint live all the time. For me to actually paint live for you and show you what I'm doing, the process of it, is. It can be very stressful. I mean, I'm used to it. I've been doing it long enough, and I kind of adopted a bit of a, well, if it works, it works. If it doesn't type of attitude. I understand that I'm human, but a lot of artists don't realize that. It takes a lot of bravery for somebody to do something like this. When you see artists, even the well-known artists that come online and they do live painting demos, that takes balls, man. Because every artist has good days, they have off days. I mean, even if an artist is capable of doing some really absolutely brilliant work, there's other days where there's days where you feel like you forgot how to paint. You're just sitting there and you look at your stuff and you're going, "This is shit I painted when I was like 10." It's like, and you get all pissed off and annoyed with yourself because you feel like you're You feel like you're regressing artistically. Well, okay, there we go. I think that'll do for our little Luna Moth guy. But yeah, so for me to be able to paint for you, I've taken a chance. I might have had to redo this, re-videotape this 5 times, or just decide scrap it. I'm not going to do it at all because it's just not working out. You know what I mean? So I really honestly suggest you show some respect to people that can do that kind of stuff because they're putting themselves a bit out on a limb for you. But that's not important, not for today. I'm very happy. Mirwan, again, thank you for this awesome suggestion. I'm going to keep working it a little bit more, but I mean, we have a very good idea. We have the characters pretty fleshed out. Of course, I need to work the hands and maybe add some detail and stuff like that. But we've already gone well over our 2 hour mark. So, listen, everybody, thanks for watching. Thanks again, Mirwan. And keep throwing in your suggestions. As you can see, they're really inspiring, and you gave me an idea that I never would have thought of on my own, especially at this particular point in my life. So you've helped add a beautiful piece of artwork to the gallery, and a video for everybody to enjoy and share. All right. So thanks, everybody. Take care.